All right, good morning. My name is Neil Peterson. I am the president of Open Design Alliance, and I'd like to welcome you to our fifth annual development conference. First off, I'll say a few words about our organization. So ODA is a nonprofit technology consortium. We were established in 1998. Our focus is solving complex problems for the CAD industry. So we take on the types of problems that are either too difficult or too expensive for companies to solve by themselves. And we make the solutions for those problems available to the industry through our memberships. We are a heavily development-centric organization. So we spend more than 80% of our revenue on R&D. We have about 80 developers on staff right now, full-time. So pretty much the whole team, except for a couple of people, are developers. We've got a very, very strong development team. And finally, we post our prices and our membership rules on our website for everybody to see. Another part of our mission is to prevent data obsolescence within the industry. And data obsolescence happens when you're using some application, you're saving files off into some proprietary format, and then in 20 years' time, the vendor goes out of business, or they stop supporting the product, and now you're stuck with all these data files that you can't read anymore at some point. And so part of our mission, we call it our 100-year commitment. We are standing behind DWG, DGN, Revit files, other formats. We want to be able to provide tools to support those formats on into the foreseeable future. So we want the ODA to be an organization that it outlasts all of us. It's going to keep going after all of us are long retired. It's going to keep serving future generations. So that is an important part of our mission, that we're protecting key data formats and key technologies into the foreseeable future. And it's important to have a nonprofit consortium responsible for this mission, because I found an interesting statistic recently online. You go back to 1955 and look at the Fortune 500 list from 1955, and you walk that through till today, and only 53 companies out of that 500 managed to stay on that list over that time period. So even at the top level of industry in the United States, there's this 90% churn rate of companies trying to stay in that group. And so it really doesn't make sense. No single for-profit company is a reliable guardian or custodian of this type of technology over the longer term, because the fortunes of for-profit companies are up and down. And so ODA is well-positioned as a nonprofit with broad industry support. We are well-positioned to be the steward of this technology in this regard. We've been going around the past 3 or 4 years talking to people in the industry and going to conferences and talking to members. And a couple of things have become very clear. One is that almost everybody in the industry has heard of Open Design Alliance. We've got very good brand recognition, name recognition for the organization. They probably have a little bit of an idea about what we do. So that's the first thing. The second thing is Teigha, not so much. After 8 years, a lot of people have never heard of it. The pickup on Teigha has been slow. And it's disappointing, but it hasn't been that surprising, because we're spending 80% of our revenue on R&D. We don't have a big marketing budget. And so what we decided is instead of splitting our resources, we're trying to do the ODA brand on the one hand and the Teigha brand, instead of dividing our resources on the two brands, that we should just focus all of our resources on the name and the brand that everybody already knows, the Open Design Alliance. We couldn't pick a better name for the organization than what we have. So Teigha is no more, and the ODA is going to live on as our main brand. And as part of that, we have updated our logo. So you can see we've got a new or minimalist type of logo and a new tagline. So the new tagline for ODA is the equalizer for CAD development. And by equalizer, we mean providing equal access to key data formats, you know, DWG and Revit and other key formats, but also providing equal access to technology. So we're building a nice portfolio of components that you can use to build CAD applications, and we're making those available to the entire industry. Okay, so then the other thing I want to discuss today is focal points for the organization. What things do we think are important, and implications of those focal points going forward? And first up, of course, is going to be DWG. DWG was developed by Autodesk in the early 80s, and by the 90s, even by the early 90s, it had become one of the most popular formats in the industry. By 1998, it was, you know, there were billions of files in existence. Even by 1998, it was the accepted format for CAD exchange. And at that time, about 500 companies in the industry, competing companies, got together, and the demand for DWG interoperability was so important at that time that those 500 companies got together and they formed a nonprofit organization with the sole purpose of providing a toolkit for DWG. And of course, I'm talking about ODA, but that was 20 years ago. That was the popularity level, the usage level 20 years ago. And since then, things have only continued to go up. As we've developed our DWG tool set, what you've seen is that, you know, Autodesk is still doing really well with all of their DWG-based tools, but now we've got a whole nother market segment of companies that are doing CAD systems based on ODA tools. So you have dozens of full CAD systems that are using DWG, using our technology as their kernel, using DWG as their native format, and thousands of other applications built on ODA technology. And the use of DWG today is still the standard file format for exchange in the industry. And, you know, millions of people are using DWG-based tools every day, and billions of files are being created. And it's important to note here that the DWG is good technology. You know, it was developed in the 80s, but it was completely redone in the mid-90s based on the experience, you know, first 15 years experience with it. And so it's, while it may be 35 years old, it's aging well. You would be hard-pressed to find a better development platform to use for building CAD applications today. And so we've got an interesting situation right now with you know, the success of the technology. I think you can't really argue with that. But at the same time that that's been going on, Autodesk, during the last, you know, 5 to 10 years, if you talk to anybody who's watching the industry, the consensus opinion is that they've really stepped back. They've walked away from the technology in the sense of doing any sort of active new development. You know, they're not putting out major features at this point. It's really, for them, it's a technology that's in maintenance mode. They're still making a lot of money selling DWG-based products, but the technology is in maintenance mode. And at the same time, over the last 5 or 6 years, we've doubled the size of our development team, and we've started several new initiatives related to DWG that I believe will be the next generation of DWG technology. And you know, I'm not talking about trivial things like adding a few fields to an object or something like that. I'm talking about adding native version control technology for DWG, which you'll see a demo of that today, which opens up a lot of possibilities for development and for end users. Things like building a web-based application development, so you can build DWG-based web applications easily. And we're also working on integrated data conversion support for DWG, and you'll see presentations about all those initiatives later today through the conference. And so we find ourselves in a position after 20 years of really being the number two company in this market segment. We are the ones who are doing the only active development, and we're coming out with some substantial new features and new technology based on DWG. And we have the resources, and we have the expertise on staff to take the lead role here. So we have this rather strange reversal of positions in the market today, and you know, we're really happy about it, because, you know, I want to emphasize that it's not legacy technology at this point. And DWG is still in heavy use, and we are getting an incredible amount of requests and ideas coming up from our team. I mentioned we've doubled our team size in the past 5 or 6 years, but we've got so much stuff coming in right now. Sergey's telling me a few weeks ago we need to double the team size again just to keep up with all of the demand coming in from member requests and all of the ideas that are coming up from our team. So we see an incredible amount of energy that's coming in from the industry supporting this technology, and we're really pleased to be at the forefront of that. So second area of focus is BIM. BIM is an area that we got into much more recently, 5 years ago or so. We did our first BIM project at the request of our members. There was a demand for a Revit interoperability solution. And so we put together a team and we've delivered a solution in that area. It's not finished yet, but you'll see the latest status of that today. We see BIM as a good area of growth. We've gotten a lot of new members coming into the organization that are just interested in the Revit technology. So it's been a good project for us. But BIM is more than just Revit. So we're looking beyond our Revit support. And I wanted to just quickly mention an interesting situation with IFC support. So we're taking on a project that we just started to provide an IFC library. And this is a little outside of what we normally do, because IFC there's an ISO spec for IFC. It's the standard exchange format for BIM. It's supported by the fine organization, the Building Smart. But even though it's a standard, there are still interoperability problems with IFC. And you have a lot of different implementations, and there are different ways to do things within the standard. So you still have compatibility problems, because there's no single implementation that everybody uses. And so we see IFC, we see the project, it's not just a way to deliver a feature that our members are asking for. They want to access IFC data. We see that there's potential beyond that to offer a standard implementation of this important format that the entire industry can use. And by doing that, we can help to eliminate some of the interoperability problems that persist, even though there's an existence of a formal standard here. And the third area of focus that is a new area for us in just the last 2 or 3 years, and that is visualization. So I wanted to announce today that we are officially in the professional visualization market now. We've got a solution. And a bit interesting history about this. So what's new? We've had a visualization solution for 20 years. We had one in 1998. So what's new about what we're doing today? And so the new part of this is that back in 1998 and historically, we had what I would call maybe a 60% visualization solution. We had a toolkit where you could, if you wanted to see a file on the screen, we could draw it nicely for you. But if you wanted to give it like a 100 megabyte drawing and then do like some interactive walkthrough or something like that, I mean, that was never going to happen with our previous technology. That was impossible. So we had this 60% implementation that gave you visual fidelity, but it didn't have a real-time graphics engine. And so we've had a group of members that like every year they're complaining, when are you guys going to get this technology finished? And at the same time, even though it may look like visualization is a separate problem from interoperability, it really isn't, actually. A lot of companies, interoperability for a lot of companies is the ability to visualize a file. That's all they need. They don't need the data access. So this technology, in addition to serving a need, a long-time need from our members, this technology really, it kind of completes and ties together a lot of our other components. And so what we're offering really is it's a first-in-class type of solution for visualization. So currently in the market, what you have is you've got a few like free toolkits and low-cost solutions. They're you get what you pay for with a free solution. You have the low end down here, and then you have a set of vendors that are doing high-end graphic solutions, and they've got good feature sets, they're fast, they work with large models, and the cost is also up here. They're really expensive. And so what we're offering is a visualization SDK it's fast, it's got a professional full feature set, it works on large models, but ours is part of an ODA membership. So for all of you, it's essentially, it's free. You can use it, it's available today, it's ready for production use, and it's our way of also giving back to the members, giving you some technology, adding value to a membership. So I'll leave you with one final thought, and that's that we've all spent some considerable amount of time and money to get here, to spend these next 2 days together, so don't be shy about introducing yourselves, coming up and talking to anyone on our team or talking to your peers. Let's make the most of the next 2 days. And thank you.